sound, and we'll go here. There we are. Okay,
Leon, you're
so.
so good looking.
Nice.
I'm gonna get a haircut soon, that'll help, okay?
A haircut? Oh, that'll be good.
I think I'm going to Jeremiah's tomorrow to get that done.
Oh, yeah, he's a haircutter now, isn't he? That's right.
Yeah. They prefer the term barber.
Oh, well. He's a stylist now. Oh boy. So,
I'm gonna go to his salon.
You should. That would be he would love that. You should call it a salon too when you see him.
Yeah.
This is a nice salon you have here, Jeremiah. I need you to style my hair.
I haven't talked with him forever. I think that'd be
kind of
rude.
So. Oh yeah. right, so intro. Welcome back to this, whatever this is. I don't have a name for it yet. We haven't titled it. Are we calling it Theology Talk? Is that official?
That's what the Discord server is.
That's true.
That's what it says
okay.
on the video,
so,
right?
Well,
Theology Talk video.
Oh, it does say that, doesn't it? Okay, so okay, that's what it is. All right. Starting over. Welcome back to Theology Talk here on Twitch on my little channel. Last time we talked about Hosea and kind of the nature of the two kingdoms and what was going on at that time,
yeah.
Historical context and everything. Today we're hoping to get all the way through chapter 3. It shouldn't be too hard. Chapter 3 is super short.
Yes, chapter 3. I actually did my homework this time.
Oh, good.
Chapter 3 is real short.
Yep. So with me today is GP Fox, sipping his little wine, and we're going to call him Tim, because that's his name.
Yeah. It's fine.
He's Tim. And I'm Goff, of course. Also Jeff. So yeah.
Don't confuse the people, Goff.
I do what I can, really. So how are you guys?
Doing great.
Good.
Blessed.
Sweet.
Just moved into a new house.
That's exciting.
Wow.
Yeah, it was terrible.
moving sucks.
In the last 3 weeks?
I hate moving.
Yep.
Well, congratulations.
This last weekend, wait, what day is it? Sunday? Starting Monday, I started moving stuff into this house, but then, like, the real work began Friday.
Mm-hmm.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the little blessings.
All right,
so.
Yeah, we finished by allegorizing chapter 1.
Right, the last part of this, the last paragraph in chapter 1.
Yeah, and I'm all for allegorization. I just wonder also how the Jews of the time, or how Jews today view this passage. And I didn't bother looking it up, verses 10 and 11.
No, me neither.
Ultimately irrelevant, probably, but...
Well,
you
know,
Daver,
the video that Mr. Fox put on the Facebook group kind of went into that a little bit, right? Prophecies of the kingdom and whatnot, what happens to the lost tribes, and this would be one of those Old Testament prophecies that, what's his name, talked about, with the big beard, yeah, Achan, that's it.
I was struggling but couldn't find Hosea to pull it up. I was like looking in the Old Testament, I just kept skipping over with my eyes.
So the notes that I took from that podcast, in the Mishnah from, this is paraphrased from a Jimmy Akin podcast that GP Fox
Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. What was the episode? I don't even remember what I shared. I've watched now like 30 of their podcasts.
I can probably find it real quick.
My headphones have been in, just like packing.
Messages, yeah. This one. is. Hang on. Don't start playing. Good. 014. MYS 014. The Mysterious Lost Tribes of Israel.
Okay.
It's an hour long, so I'm not going to start it at all.
Right.
Yeah. But he says that in the Mishnah, there was, and I didn't bother writing down their names because I can't spell. So there's one rabbi who says that they won't ever come back, and another that says that they would. So there's kind of a conflict between the various teachers of the Hebrews in that, you know, will the lost tribe ever be found again, and will they, maybe not. In the Talmud, there's a third option, which I thought was really interesting, and it says,
Do you mind really quick if we define Mishnah? I just looked it up because I had to remember what that was, and according to Google, which, you know, fallible as it is, an authoritative collection of exegetical material embodying the oral tradition of Jewish law and forming the first part of the so.
Yeah.
Isn't it essentially a commentary?
So
yeah.
The Talmud is the comprehensive written version of the Jewish oral law and the subsequent commentaries. And the Mishnah is the original written version of the oral law. And then there's a Gemara as well, which I don't have anything about. So the Mishnah
and I bet
is
they're only like 10 pages.
Is earlier, and then the Talmud is later but expanded.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yep. Okay. But there's a rabbi in the Talmud who says that if their deeds are good, then they'll come back, but if they're not good, then they won't. Right, so if they right, and that kind of follows, you know, the you know, if they do what's good in the eyes of the Lord will bless them and return them to the land, kind of a thing.
You know, have you ever taken the Dr. Thomas really class on anything where he gets into his talks with Jewish rabbis and things like that?
No, the
where
only
he essentially proclaims them you know, followers of the gospel without Jesus. He really does. And it's really interesting how much of their traditions and theology are based on works for being such huge proponents of God's forgiveness, God leading them out of, because that's mm-hmm. the case he makes always, is the Egyptian, you know, leaving.
Right.
The Exodus is that
Exodus
they,
and Passover.
God does that outside of any merit of man, and that he does all these works for Jews, for Israelites at the time without any obedience or provocation from them
mm-hmm.
at all. And so he would put them in the same light as us who follow the gospel. We just don't have, they just don't have Jesus. And I hope I'm,
right,
you know, representing his position well, but he's essentially said that. We've even asked him in Bible study, so why aren't Jews going to heaven if they follow the same theology that we do? And he's like, oh, no, they don't have Jesus.
Yeah.
And so, which is huge, but it seems like
Professor Thomas from Concordia, Portland.
Yeah.
And so, but their essential existence.
Can't go to heaven?
No, I wouldn't say that.
Oh. No.
I would say that.
Well, that's what he just said. Why aren't they going to heaven?
Say what?
Well, okay.
No, I'm
so.
You would ask Professor Thomas.
Uh-huh. That is what.
Well,
Tim
right,
said.
That question was asked.
Yeah. So the question is.
And if are you going based on the Pauline, you know, what is it in Romans where he talks about Jews? Is that where the basis of this question coming from?
No,
it's coming from what you said.
Yeah, I think the question is, are religious Jews pagans.
No. They're elder brothers in the faith.
Okay. They're, I mean, they're missing Christ.
Right.
Like, definitionally.
Yeah.
He's the cornerstone of our faith.
They're still God's chosen people.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
A role in salvation. And the end times will be, there'll be a great conversion of Jews when it comes towards the end times, according to everything.
Interesting.
I understand where we're getting that. Like I said, you're talking about in the epistles, right? Where Paul talks about the Jews as God's chosen people, right? Or are you getting that?
I'm just getting that from my church.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So we're the
new Israel, but the Jews have a special place because they are God's chosen people. That ethnic group is special.
Okay.
That's so interesting.
Yeah.
That is a rabbit trail right there.
That is part of Catholic doctrine right there.
Interesting. Cause
no,
it's
really interesting.
Yeah, I've been taught and have heard that the promises of all of the prophecies and the promises promised to the Israelites in the Old Testament are fulfilled in Christ, and so they have to be Christians in order to be even the Messianic Jews are Judaizers, right? That's what they are.
Not if they're Christian.
Yeah.
Well,
so you're talking about a great conversion that will cause Christendom among that group of people. Is that what you're saying? It's not like Jews by their own merit and their old beliefs will be their original soteriology, which some would say didn't even develop until like 100 AD or 100 BC. Like, they will have to convert to loving Jesus. Yeah, okay.
As much as everyone has to, yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
So because within the Catholic faith, mm-hmm. you have to be Catholic to go to church or to go to heaven. Okay. No
right.
one's saved outside the church. But what does that mean? Vatican II has said that salvation is God's domain. He set up through revelation, through the scripture, through the tradition. You have to be a Christian to be saved.
Okay.
Yes.
At which point, that's what we've been told. God can do whatever he wants.
Sure.
But
right.
The Jews are special. They're a special ethnic group. They're his chosen people.
Paul seems to think so in Romans 9.
Interesting.
So.
Yes. We have now been adopted into God's family, but I'm still a Gentile.
Right.
I'm not a Jew.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the Jews are special.
Okay, interesting.
Can I just read something out of, as we talk about Hosea, it's really funny that I'm turning to Romans 9 just to look at that, and it says in verse 25 of chapter 9, it actually references Hosea, as he also says in Hosea, I will call not my people my people, and she who is unloved will love it.
Oh, that's right
and
in our chapter.
Be
that's exciting.
In the place
that's,
where they were told, you are not my people, there they will be called
right
sons
yeah.
of the living
yeah,
God.
Yeah, that's right where we are at. That's cool.
Yeah. That's
okay.
cool that we – Holy Spirit's with us, gentlemen.
Good catch there. Good catch.
All right. Would you like to read? Because I like to read.
Yeah, go ahead and read, Mr. Fox.
I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Edition.
That's what I have up, so that's good.
Okay, well, mine's also New Revised Standard Version, Catholic Edition. So
okay.
Let's see if it's any different. Starting at chapter 2. Mm-hmm. Say to your brother, Amy, and to your sister, Ruhama, Israel, plead with your mother, plead for she is not my wife, and I am not her husband, that she put away her whoring from her face and her adultery from between her breasts, or I will strip her naked and expose her as in the day she was born, and make her like a wilderness, and turn her into a parched land, and kill her with thirst. Upon her children also I will have no pity, because they are children of whoredom, for their mother has played the whore. She who conceived them has acted shamefully, for she said, I will go after my lover. They give me my bread and my water, my wool and my flax, my oil and my drink. Therefore, I will hedge her up. I will hedge up her way with thorns, and I will build a wall against her, so that she cannot find her path. She shall pursue her lovers, but not overtake them, and she shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then she shall say, I will go and return to my first husband, for it was better with me than now. She did not know that it was I who gave her the grain, the wine, and the oil, and who lavished upon her silver and gold that they used for Baal. Therefore, I will take back my grain in its time, and my wine in its season, and I will take away my wool and my flax, which were to cover her nakedness. Now I will uncover her shame in the sight of her lovers, and no one shall rescue her out of my hand. I will put an end to all her mirth, her festivals, her new moons, her Sabbaths, and all her appointed festivals. I will lay waste her vines and her fig trees, of which she said, these are my hay, which my lovers have given me. I will make them a forest, and the wild animals shall devour them. I will punish her for the festival days of the Baals, when she offered incense to them, and decked herself with her ring and jewelry, and went after her lovers, and forget me, says the Lord. Therefore, I will not allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. From there I will give her her vineyard and make the valley of Achor a door of hope. There she shall respond as in the days of her youth, as at the time when she came out of the land of Egypt. On that day, says the Lord, you will call me my husband, and no longer will you call me my Baal. For I will remove the names of the Baals from her mouth, and they shall be mentioned by name no more. I will make for you a covenant on that day with the wild animals, the birds of the air, and the creeping things of the ground. And I will abolish the bow, the sword, and war from the land. And I will make you lie down in safety. And I will take you for my wife forever. I will take you for my wife in righteousness and in justice, in steadfast love, and in mercy. I will take you for my wife in faithfulness, and you shall know the Lord. On this day I will answer, says the Lord. I will answer the heavens, and they shall answer the earth. And the earth shall answer the grain, the wine, and the oil, and they shall answer Jezreel, and I will sow him for myself in the land, and I will have pity on Ruhamah. And I will say to Lo Ami, you are my people. He shall say, you are my God.
Can you see me or not?
No.
Okay, hold on. Cool. That actually, I kept you, but I couldn't. You guys froze on me, and I had to reconnect there.
That's fine.
So you're telling me that this, everything you just read there, that's like, the NASB is hard for me to understand. Are you an NRSV?
NRSV.
Right. That's slightly better than the RSV. there was a lot of stuff in there. Mine just has the definitions of what those names mean, not the attempts at the words themselves. So.
Right.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Those are in the footnotes in mine.
Yep. And it's good to know. I mean, it helps. So let's get into this then. Yeah, say to your brother Ami and to your sister Ruhamah. Right. So
Ami is brother.
Right. Ami is my people, and Ruhamah is no pity, or pitied. Yep. And we're talking to Jezreel, right? That's the first brother, if we remember from chapter 1. Hosea's first child is named Jezreel, which means God sows. And so we're asking God sows to tell pitied and my people to plead with their mother, who is God's people as a whole, right? If we're talking about the, yeah.
It's very interesting. One, in a practical sense, that we would never stand for this today, would we? Like, where we would have a child go and confront the whoredom of mother and absolutely get in her face about that. That is that is not socially acceptable for us.
Mom, stop being a whore.
Right.
And I had a question in verse 2. Mm-hmm. Are they divorced?
I don't think so.
Because I don't remember what yours said exactly.
Verse 2?
Yeah.
Yeah, for she, mine says, for she is not my wife and I am not her husband. Is that not a divorce decree?
No.
What reality are they living in there?
She's not acting like my wife and I'm not acting like her husband because she's off with her lovers?
Because in, I'm not sure if it's Ezekiel or whatever, there is a point where God does declare divorce on Israel. And I was wondering if this is a manifestation of that.
Yeah, I don't know.
He does issue her. He does say it in a metaphorical sense. Like, I am giving her a slip of divorce.
Plead with your mother, for she is not my wife and I am not her husband. So plead that she puts away her whoredom because our relationship is not working, maybe?
Yeah.
Do this, right? Or the punishment as my unfaithful wife is that I'm going to expose this sin to her. So I think it's not a actual writ of divorce. It's more of she's not my wife because she's going out to see all these other dudes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not her husband for the same reason, right? If you have a wife, you're only for her, and she's only for you. That's
Hosea's faithfulness is still acting as the husband in that case. Like, God put up with over 1,000
right.
years of infidelity from his people.
So this is a fed up husband in the beginning of this, right?
Do you think it's an emotionally provocative text
literal?
Yeah.
Well, it might be literal, but it's definitely emotional. He's a very angry husband.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He sends her off into the wilderness, has no pity on the children, because she essentially told him to his face, you know, hey husband, I'm gonna go off with Steve and Joe and
they give me what I need.
They give me what I need. Yeah.
And then, of course, yeah, that kind of goes in verse 5, but
mm-hmm.
then verse 7, verse 8, she does not recognize that it is I who gave her the grain, the
right.
new wine,
yeah.
and the oil. It's so interesting that she's so, like, swiftly stupid that she just doesn't recognize where her goods and where her where the things she thinks that she needs to survive come from.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, that's not, it's no one I would ever be around, but you hear about stories of people like that,
right?
And you have the terrible male aspect of just trying to sleep around, but then you also hear about the women who just use the things, and then they're still sleeping around with other people while they're taking the stuff from the one guy.
Right.
So, I mean, that's just human nature right there.
Yeah.
Oh, it is.
Point out.
Yeah. It's that's sin. And it's,
praise
it,
the Lord,
it's
part of our
it's
world.
Also...
I want to say human nature. I want to say fallen human nature. That's
right. Yeah. It's
right.
It's original sin.
Yeah.
It's concupiscence.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if you get back to, like, evolutionarily, right, women are rendered disabled when they're pregnant and breastfeeding. They can't really go out into the field and, you know, hunt a boar or something.
Mm-hmm.
right.
holding a suckling bait, right? So they need someone who's going to go out and get them resources and bring it back. Okay?
Yeah.
And so if they recognize that, they will then choose someone who will be a good provider, right? But then there's always, you know, the desire for whatever reason to have the other genes mixed in there.
Mm-hmm.
This might be a weird diversion. Studies out there that say that upwards of 5%, and they found this out through genetic, they're trying to figure out genetic disorders and diseases and come up with better treatments for them. Well, if you're going to do that, you really need to make sure whose genes are involved. So they tested, and then they extrapolated data out to try to see, and it's upwards of 5% of people who think their dad is their dad, it's not their dad.
Weird. That's crazy.
Mom has sex with someone else.
Yeah.
And then it's having
sounds low to me.
That kid.
Sorry, my cynicism gets the best of me, and I'm just like, the other ones just haven't gotten tested. It's probably closer to 10%.
Right.
But you're, it's really interesting that you say that. That really does paint that picture really well.
Mm-hmm.
Not that the Bible is about us necessarily. It's probably more about God and revealing who he is, but that's a, it's just a really clear
right.
thought. Helps
yeah.
me crystallize that a little bit in verse 7 and 8.
Yeah, and so to bring it, like, to the church and God's people, right, we have all of these things that we end up worshiping, like our grain, our bread, our TVs, our computers, our jobs, our houses, and we think that we
our
provided
liturgy.
Those things. Liturgy.
If you're worshiping liturgy, that's not too far off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the point, the point being that God provides all of these breads, right, to us, and
right.
we don't acknowledge
Amen.
It. Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's the thrust of this whole kind of, she didn't know that I gave her all of the things that she thought she was getting from these other sources.
And when it, like, when you discover that you're going after other things, and then verse 12 talks about, then I'm going to take it away.
Right.
That's verse.
It's 9. It starts in 9. I'm going to take back my grain.
Yeah, right.
Yep. And I'm going to uncover what's been going on and show the whole world that this is what's up.
Well, I think it's more than that. I'll uncover her shame in the sight of her lovers, and no one shall rescue her out of my hand. Meaning, I'm going to take away all of her resources, and they're not going to give you anything, honey.
Right.
Yeah. 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 The payment is going to go away. Punish the festivals. And then we get to 14. Right?
Right.
So once it's all been taken away, and she's realized now that all of the resources come from her first husband, he then allures her. He brings her to the wilderness, away from all the temptations, and speaks tenderly, and then he begins to give her things again, and she responds as she did when they were first engaged, when they came out of the land of Egypt. Right, so there's redemption
Hosea,
there.
Hosea is linking it even in this statement, even though he's talking to his kid.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He's linking it to Israel.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
I
right.
don't think Hosea and Gomer came out of the land of Egypt.
No. 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 This is in the northern kingdom generations after.
Oh yeah.
After that, long generations.
It's a very, it's a definite concrete pattern, though, in the Old Testament, constantly calling everything back to the Exodus event.
Mm-hmm.
And all, you know, one of the most popular phrases in Old Testament is, remember the great things the Lord has done.
Right.
This just speaks right back into that.
Well, and that just kind of goes back to human gratitude. even God is like, I've done this all this crap for you, and you're still pissing my cornflakes. What? I'm a jealous God. I've done this stuff for you.
So yeah,
right.
You're just exactly. Gonna do what you want. Fine, I'll take the blessings away. You'll
come back.
Come back. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah, yeah. It's good. It's so good.
Now here's the question, and I'm always the last one to ask this because I very rarely like to go this place because I think there's so many ways to talk about the Lord in this situation. Mm-hmm. How do we apply Course Hosea to, can we apply it in our modern day?
I think like that's what I've been doing. That's what we've been doing, I think.
Right. We're not talking. Yeah, talk more with that, because we've been applying it back to Egypt. I feel we've been doing a great job of talking about it in context, which I really appreciate. But the fact is, we are not Israel in the Northern Kingdom,
right?
And you know, we are adulterous whores, but are we just to take us? Are we just to think generally in that respect? We are generally whores seeking after everything but it's our fathers, or are we too?
We're only whores if we're whores. Okay. I don't believe in the pile of dung covered in snow.
Sure.
Okay? So, what I've been doing is the easily thing to way to connect this to today is humans are human.
Mm-hmm.
When I was teaching history, things that humans did, they're going to do it again. Not meaning is there's going to be an exact Third Reich again in Germany. Yeah, no, that won't happen again.
Right.
But the themes of humanity never change.
Yeah.
Okay. People are like, oh my gosh, why would you need a weapon? It's like, because there are bad people out there. If you don't believe there's bad people out there, you're dumb. Because that's all of human history is bad people.
Right.
Right? Within the second generation of humans after the fall, the brother killed his brother, bro. Okay, that's just to show you.
Yeah.
Humans are humans. So no matter how far back you go, you're going to see, hey, you got them gold diggers, right? That's literally what this lady is. She's a gold digger,
mm-hmm.
okay, who's then a whore.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
She's getting her stuff from a dude and then sleeping around on the side.
Yeah.
Right. This is
that
timeless.
Still happens today.
Yeah. 100%.
But the question that goes into a whole thing about weapons in defense of yourself. But the question I have though is, are we as the people of God, which I think we are. I think it's fair to say that those of us in Christ are His children, His people, the new Israel-ish of sorts.
But
so we don't have any of this like old Sinai covenant and promise. So then what does our condemnation and our resurrection look like?
All have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God.
Right.
Right. And everyone who is in Christ
so,
is a new
creation. So there is going to be temporal issues for sin. That
everyone.
Yeah. That's a fact of life. Right.
This is
sorry.
Why
issues was a bad word. Punishment. Yeah.
Jeffrey,
mm-hmm.
does he know? Because that's a Catholic idea. The temporal punishment for sin.
Oh, that's a Christian idea.
It?
Yeah.
It's a Christian idea.
Really? You believe in purgatory now? Nice to know.
No.
Well.
Wait, what about.
So that's
I'm,
what purgatory is.
What's your definition of temporal? Are you thinking corporeal or temporal? Because within the function of time. Or is there a function of time within purgatory? I don't actually know that.
There may or may not be. We don't know.
Yeah.
Then let's not go there.
So
we can't be a certain on that.
So
temporal, by definition, doesn't that have to do with time?
No, it means it has to do with you will deal with it now.
They're
forgiven, but there's going to be bad things that happen to you because you did.
I think there's always been that hint, both within our four fathers in Judaism and in Christianity. There has always been a
follow me, do what you want, and you'll have $1 million.
Right, plant $1,000 seed.
Okay. If you just tried to follow God hard enough, you'll be a millionaire.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah, it's always been with us. So everyone believes in temporal punishments for sin?
No.
No. I mean, it's
I wasn't expecting the purgatory question.
No, but I think there's definitely place. So Phil Brandt always used to say,
I've forgotten about that.
There's just, we don't put God in this box where we can say, hey, we can understand the very nature and all things.
So, of course we can't understand God.
And, right, but the point of that saying is, look, we look at a hurricane and we say, oh man, God doesn't love that hurricane, but he'll use it. Well, that's not scriptural. God controls the freaking weather, right? He can use that as a mode of judgment if he desires.
But, yeah,
and that is...
He doesn't.
No, I don't think so either.
Well, I mean, that was at least a contemplation we were encouraged to take as we were going through Phil Brandt's class.
Yeah, yeah. He was trying to get you to struggle with the problem of evil.
Right.
But the problem of evil, I would argue, is better designed as defined as the world was set in motion. Right? There's certain laws that the world works by, right?
Okay.
You can learn about them in physics, right?
Mm-hmm.
And at which point, there's going to be weather systems, and sometimes the weather systems are going to be more powerful than others, or there's going to be earthquakes, because this is what is necessary for the planet to be the way it is, to where life can be.
Yeah.
At which point, just because God knows it's going to happen, and he's set the evolutionary and the cosmic processes that make our universe, doesn't mean he wills it, but it will happen, and he can use it for good in his plan.
Right.
He does not will evil. God does not will evil.
Yeah. That's...
What is? That's that's a interesting topic, but
that's a digression.
No,
we'll talk about weather systems another time.
When we look at these passages, God is causing all sorts of nasty things for Israel. What he's allowing.
Allowing. It's
yes.
their choice.
Right.
They can follow God.
Right.
Right.
But there are consequences and blessings. Those two issues of within the covenant, there are blessings and there are curses.
Mm-hmm.
People would look at that. It depends on how you view things. Are you viewing them from a heavenly perspective in which God is still right even if bad things happen? Or are you looking
God says, follow me and I'll protect you. Oh, you're not following me? No protection. Bad stuff happens. You're going to follow me? Protection.
Yeah.
Oh, you're not
right.
Follow
me? You're saying he pulls his presence.
He pulls his protection, his blessing. He does not will them to be
destroyed.
And
that's clear.
He wishes them to follow him.
Yeah.
Right.
And we can talk about the storm cloud of the gospel, right? It falls in areas, and it's not falling in the West right now, probably because we are an idolatrous whore kind of a nation. Society, culture. it's the idea that
he made it up.
I don't think I did.
That's fine as long as it wasn't something I just missed.
No.
I
we do talk about in terms of where God's blessings go, like where is the gospel being heartily and like passionately followed.
So it's raining.
Blessings not follow.
Yeah, it's
it is difficult.
Mm-hmm. And it's raining currently in Africa and South America.
And China.
China.
We're having it too good.
Mm-hmm.
We're having it too good. That is our main problem. Our
number one
cause of death is heart disease. It's from sedentary lifestyle.
Yep.
Too many people.
Yep. And right. Right. And I see us.
God telling
right.
You
Leon says we need persecution. Just like I've been saying.
Right, and I think we
darn right. Long distance high five.
We don't need it. It's coming.
It's coming.
Yes,
100%.
Right.
It's coming.
Yeah, 100%.
Here's the thing, though, Leon. Here's a question for you. Do you hope it comes in your lifetime as a vehicle for sharing the gospel?
No.
Why not?
Because I have a job where I can't just. I can't.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you have children.
I have kids. I don't. No, I don't want it.
Yeah, I know you don't want it, but do we want versus what is good for the kingdom? Is that even a fair question?
Touché.
Do we need some persecution? Heck yeah, we do.
We're already getting.
Yeah, it's it.
And persecution is ramping up.
Well,
I gotta look up. There's a quote. It's some bishop, and I think he's in the Midwest. So it's like not a super like anti-Christian area, but he's like, "I will die in my bed. My successor will die in prison, and his successor will die from martyrdom
by the sword or something like that."
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I've seen that.
Praise the Lord. I think that's, you know, back in the early church days, it was a blessing to be counted a martyr.
There was somebody that I listened to who said, you know, the era of Constantinianism, you could call it Christendom, is going away. The time that the church had a place of preference in society is swiftly vanishing.
That ended
and
200 years ago.
We're gonna go.
Well, there could always be in America a third great revival among Protestants.
There could be. I doubt it.
Who's gonna start it from our couches?
I doubt it.
Maybe this.
It's gonna happen on Twitch.
Popular.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's gonna happen on Twitch. Sure. I mean, I'm right here with you, but okay.
Right. So right now.
Feel free to donate.
Oh man!
According to Acts, Jeff will distribute the money equitably.
Equitably, yep. So right now I see us kind of in this parable, having our grain and wine and all the things taken away from us.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's where we're at in the parable. We haven't been dragged into the wilderness to be lured once again yet. That's gonna come.
Right.
But right now, we're being laid waste. We're being punished.
Well, here's
and
the
all
problem.
Of this
right now, we are currently chasing after our lovers.
Yeah.
God is about to pull the resources.
Yeah.
I agree with you.
Yep.
And it's super interesting, though, as... Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead. As a society, we're all messed up.
Yeah.
And where is Ezekiel? I think it's in Ezekiel also. I'm not entirely certain, but people had already been thrown into Babylon, I believe. Yeah, and
So Ezekiel happens in Babylon.
I'm talking Ezekiel.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
So the funny thing about Ezekiel is that when Ezekiel comes to them with a message of how the Lord can and will restore them, but first they need to go through punishment, the people's response isn't an altogether what is it called when America a revival? It didn't happen. Ezekiel went and preached this message and God's like, okay, some will listen, some won't, and
right.
you still have to preach to them anyway. But a large part of people that went into captivity and even those who stayed behind, largely they didn't go back to following God right away. It's
yeah, I want to say it was 2/3 didn't.
Yeah, it's very interesting that even the persecution that we might
something like that.
Maybe it's something not to even pray for or think about, because we may not even go. Wasn't it at 9/11? I heard this stat, and it may be completely false, but I definitely heard it from more than one source, is that the result of 9/11 wasn't that people revolted or hated Islam. A majority of converts after the 9/11 attacks were Islamic.
Mm.
Like, a lot of people started looking into the religion, found something to their liking, and actually started following.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Became
Interesting.
Muslims.
Interesting.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I would argue that is because there's a God-shaped hole within everyone's soul.
Yep.
And so,
yep, I agree.
If
sorry, a song came into my head when
you
said that.
So if we have limp-wristed, wussy evangelization, wussy churches that don't have doctrine, that don't, because Islam is effing intense.
Yes.
No alcohol. No, that boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, very law,
right.
All law.
And then they're getting all of these new converts. Yeah, they're also reproducing a lot. It's by design, but it's not a wimpy religion.
No.
It's a
right.
This is how you be a man. This is how you be strong. This is how you this. And I feel like problem with the West is we think being feminine in our evangelization, and I use that as a broad feminine
no
term, right
nurturing, It's like,
right.
That's what, because it used to be an accepted part of psychology was that a man has to break away from mom
mm-hmm.
in order to be a man.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He has to learn what it means to be a man and be around manly things and other men.
Right.
And now it's like,
look at statistics. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Not sure. Am I good?
You are.
You guys frozen? Okay,
no,
all right.
You're good. Keep
well,
talking.
A large statistics say that the church is largely feminized this day.
Yeah.
There is not there's one denomination that can boast a 50-50 a 1-to-1 ratio of men to women within their denomination. Otherwise, it's not even close, and I'm sure Catholicism has this same issue. It's closer to 65-35 women to men in terms of who supports this religion.
Yeah.
And so how do you get men in the door?
Well,
you challenge them.
You challenge them.
You make it hard. Mm-hmm.
You give them quests.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's why we're doing apologetics right now.
Yeah.
Because
in video games.
Right.
Yeah.
Because
we're doing apologetics
it's fulfilling. What we need to do is put exclamation marks on top of our pastors and priests. That would do it.
I don't know. Maybe get them out of dresses.
I don't know about that. No. No.
Heck no.
The theological significance of vestments is too good.
It's really interesting. If you go and look online, there's an academic report from Biola that talks about this very thing, about the feminization of Christendom.
Mm-hmm.
And it started in the 13th century is where they think it started.
I'm sure it's been going on
for...
Yeah,
as soon as they can frickin' uncover their hair.
Okay, so...
It's jokes.
Legally, that's a joke. So verse 16, right?
That's a joke. Oh, I love that song. Congratulations.
Yep. So verse 16, right? On that day, says the Lord, you will call me my husband, and no longer will you call me my Baal, for I will remove the names of the Baals from her mouth, and they shall be mentioned by name no more. I will make for you a covenant on that day with the wild animals, the birds of the air, etc. So we have a day in which a new covenant is made. Right? So I want to say, I'm going to throw this out there, that this day is Easter.
Yes. Oh,
yeah.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, 100%.
This is obviously a Jesus
mm-hmm.
prophecy.
And
I will abolish the bow, the sword, and war from the land.
Yep. Yep, this is all Jesus.
By AD 70, Israel will be destroyed. But whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so then on that day, which is the same day, this Easter, I will answer, says the Lord, I'll answer the heavens, and they shall answer the earth, and the earth shall answer the grain, the wine, and the oil, and they shall say, God sows, which is Jezreel, and I will sow him for myself in the land, and I will have pity on no pity, and I will say to not my people, you are my people, and he shall say, you are my God. Right, so that I want to say
the Lord.
Is
good when we are not.
Is the birth of the church.
Yes.
Yep.
So it says in verse 19, talking about that on that day, and I will take for you my wife forever.
Right, yes.
I will take you for my wife in righteousness and in justice and steadfast love and mercy.
Mm-hmm.
I will take you for my wife in faithfulness, and you shall know the Lord. That's obvious. I mean, obviously we're looking back with the New Testament in mind, and it's just so obvious.
Yep. It's so good. That's like the best part of my reading.
Yeah,
from
Jews,
these last two
Jews
weeks.
Don't have resolution to this, do they?
No.
The Northern Kingdom was never reconciled. The Southern Kingdom was a, I don't know, a shell of its former self.
Yeah.
Their restoration.
They, quote unquote,
was garbage.
Right. They don't have this day of the Lord yet. They're still waiting.
Yeah.
You
think it happened in, like, what, it was in 1940s or something when they gave Israel back that land?
No.
No, because they haven't rebuilt the temple.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
They don't have a temple. They actually can't go on the temple.
Right.
The Temple Mount is controlled by the Muslims.
Because it's
Muslim
the,
now. Yeah.
The Dome of the Rock is a mosque. Right.
If you go and you say a prayer on the Temple Mount and you're Jewish, you'll be arrested.
Wow.
Yep. It's intense over there. They don't mess around.
Correct. But oh my gosh, we're so persecuted. It's so much. There's just so much.
Yeah.
So bad. It's so bad in America.
Yeah. We literally have to redefine persecution to put ourselves under it. It's yeah. garbage.
Yeah. Not to say that it's not coming.
No.
I was persecuted once. Then I took an arrow to the knee.
Took an arrow to the knee.
Saint Sebastian memes.
Right.
And then the restoration in chapter 3.
Oh, chapter 3.
Right.
Quite right indeed. I'll read it.
Would you like to read that, Mr. Fox?
According to my thing on Bible Gateway, it says, further assurances of God's redeeming love.
Yep.
Hosea 3. The Lord said to me again, go! Love a woman who has a lover is an adulteress, just as the Lord loves the people of Israel. Though they turn to other gods and love brazen cakes, so I bought her for 15 shekels of silver and a homer of barley and a measure of wine. And I said to her, you must remain as mine for many days. You shall not play the whore. You shall not have intercourse with a man, nor I with you. For the Israelites shall remain many days without king or prince, without sacrifice or pillar, without ephod or teraphim. Afterward, the Israelites shall return and seek the Lord their God and David their king. They shall come in awe to the Lord and to his goodness in the latter days.
What a weird passage. first of all, are they talking about Gomer? I think a lot of people think that they're talking about Gomer.
Yeah, I
which
don't,
in English it would help if they used the word the instead of a in verse one.
Oh.
It'd be more poignant anyway.
I'm pretty sure it's Gomer. Yeah.
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 The Lord said to me this, and so I bought her for 15 shekels of silver and a homer of barley and a measure of wine.
I hope that's not a lot.
It's I think it's pretty significant.
Is it Jesus?
Oh, that would make total 30 sense.
Pieces of silver?
30 pieces of silver.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're shekels.
But I mean they're silver.
If it was talents, that's a lot.
Yeah. It's a price to be paid for purchasing the wife.
Do you think she got like taken into like she had to buy him from the pimp, even after he'd married her?
Well, she has a.
I think he's purchasing her as a prostitute.
No,
his
she.
Choice.
I don't think so. She has a. Oh, maybe. I mean.
Maybe.
It could be. I think it's a bride price that she would have paid to her father.
Oh, okay. Okay, yeah, okay, the dowry.
Yeah.
Oh.
That okay. I think that makes more sense. Because she still has it's still the Jewish culture, and she still has, you know, all of that stuff going on.
Yeah, that would be her fallback.
So.
So the Israelites remain many days without
the 10 is that like the 10 gold coins that Jesus talks about when the finding the lost? Like, is that the dowry we're talking about, the Jewish dowry?
I don't think so.
Remember?
I don't know what you're referencing.
Well, the parable of the 10 lost, the parable of the lost coin. Where
she has 10 coins, loses one, and goes and finds
loses
it.
Loses one. It's thought that that is the fallback dowry where... If her husband were to die or leave her, she would still have her father's fallback money. Is that what we're talking, you think, here?
Could be. I don't think so.
I don't know how.
In the ancient world, when you would marry somebody, you would pay her father a price,
dowry, okay, got it.
To take her off his hands.
So he would have already paid this, though, because he married her.
Yeah, that's why I'm confused as well. So I think he actually paid for her as a prostitute for 15 shekels.
Yeah.
And then for this time, he's like, I got you. I own you for this time because I paid for you. so you don't get to go four rounds.
That could be too. That could be as well.
Yeah, he bought her for days, it said.
I think he bought her.
Yeah, like long term.
It could be. Even, yeah.
So we're married. You're running off. Fine, I'll pay your price.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The price that's needed to be paid.
Oh, I see. Because right. Yeah, because she.
This would be a far better Christological.
So he marries her. She runs off, and then he pays the price to bring her back. I like that.
He's now paying. He's the John, and she's the prophet.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Paid the price. Yeah. Okay. Okay. I can.
That's what we're talking.
Yeah. That's.
Right. I see. It's smart when Leon says it. Right. Okay. I get how this cast works.
I didn't understand what you were saying.
And that's why you've got to determine whether 15 shekels is a lot of money. And assuming we're talking in a allegorical sense, it's got to be a tremendous amount of money.
Well, I have a Google machine.
Do shekels to dollars if you could. shekels to U.S. dollars, please.
actually, it had it, and it was like $4.
Okay.
A shekel was about 11 grams of silver. A homer is about 6 bushels.
Wow.
Yeah, $15 Israeli new shekels. That's nowadays a translation, conversion rate. 15 Israeli new shekels is $4.20. So in
estimating for inflation, it would have been a lot of money back then.
Okay. And the interesting thing is, I don't know. Verse 4, and with all the other stuff that we've been reading and know about the covenant, that Judaism is possibly not a religion of works righteousness. Like, just he's wanting them to fulfill the covenant. I shall be your God, you will be my people. Make me your God. Live without a king or prince or without sacrifice or sacred pillar or without ephod or household idols.
For
the love of me, do it. You know?
Okay, I'll be right back. My kid just woke up.
Okay.
No worries.
So I bought her for 15 shekels, and I said to her, you must remain mine for many days. You shall not play the whore. You shall not have intercourse with a man, nor I with you. So we're
he's asking
abstaining.
For a celibacy period.
Yeah, we're abstaining. Yep.
Yeah.
And in the same way, right, for, because, also, as the Israelites shall remain many days without king or prince, without sacrifice or pillar, without ephod or teraphim, afterwards, after that period of abstinence, they shall return and seek the Lord their God and David their king, and they shall come in awe to the Lord and his goodness in the latter days, which I would assume is now.
Right.
So I think that this is kind of tied to the day in the earlier chapter, that the period of many days is going to be the time from
the chaotic time of them having to live under the
all of the intertestamental, all of the time between when they broke their covenant here in Hosea's day to the Easter.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. I'd say that's a really good way to look at it. Let me see. Lord, their God, they will come with awe to the Lord and to his goodness in the last days.
Yeah.
Interesting, interesting. And so, you know, Judaism, you know, speaking of what Fox was talking about earlier about how exclusive or how intense Islam is,
mm-hmm.
like, Judaism's the exact same way. I was listening to Ben Shapiro, and he's like, we don't want you to become Jewish.
Right.
We hate that idea.
Right.
It takes like 3 years of consistent full-time study to be considered a Jew.
Yeah. And if you dig into historic Christianity, it's also a hard religion.
Yeah.
And it should be. And that's definitely something that we've lost over the centuries.
Cause
that we're
should it be? We don't have the same impetus to behave as they do. We do, and it should be a stronger impetus,
mm-hmm.
but we all know how people react when given free money.
Yeah.
It's not like they're going to work harder for said money.
Right. That's the
there's
nature of
there's
it all.
There's a natural banging your head against the wall that mm-hmm. comes with Christianity and the faith, is that there has to be a missiology behind and a heart that God has set ablaze by His Holy Spirit. You know?
Yeah.
It's
Welcome
just
back.
An interesting.
I'm gonna have to be done for tonight.
That's fine. We're pretty much done.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you guys keep going. Have fun without me. I'll talk to you guys later.
Roger.
Bye.
Roger.
Bye, Leon.
Bye.
Bye.
Anyways, we can stop tonight also. So.
Yeah. And that's
praise
that's...
the Lord. He is good. A lot of things learned tonight.
Yeah. Hosea is really good. I'm liking
yeah.
it. Yeah. Yeah. Good times. So
I think we should move even faster through it, though, personally. We're never going to finish it by summer's end at this rate.
No, we won't. And, I mean,
I think we should.
I don't know if we can. We've taken an hour to go through two chapters, and one of those chapters is a paragraph.
Right.
So
I'm wondering if we should try to focus on verses and synopsis a little more. Because we're not trying to become a commentary, are we? We're trying to
no,
read the Bible.
We're just chatting about it. And
yeah, we're
and
just trying to read the Bible.
Those are the things. These are all the things that were interesting in here.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I like the idea of just letting it go as it goes. I don't know.
Okay. Cool.
What do you mean? What's your by
Well, I thought your purpose
synopsis.
In this was to get the Bible read. You mm-hmm. want to be more of a capturer and a
mm-hmm.
you know, an absorber of scripture, and
yeah.
you know, we do that in a way, but in another way we're just becoming a commentary. And when you read a commentary, it just definitely it doesn't help you with your the sheer, you know, number of things you can get to, you know.
Interesting.
If we went through it, here's kind of in a way that, you know, because you can't possibly read through with a lot of satisfaction certain books of the Bible, I can't give you a synopsis of Jeremiah where we actually read Jeremiah in our time together. It literally takes 6 hours of silent reading to get through that book.
Right.
That's half of a day, and most of a day's work. The way I go about it is find like significant verses that kind of sum up a chapter, and then I sum up that chapter.
Interesting.
So. Yeah, it's not horribly fruitful, but you get more through it, in a faster way, and you read it more as a, I don't know, a novice would.
Interesting.
From a helicopter view.
We might try that.
I mean, it might just help you get more of the word, rather than like we're talking about a bunch of stuff that I don't know. Do you?
I thought it was all fruitful.
It was all fruitful. It was. But a lot of it you know already. So,
so
the things that we don't know are the actual words of Scripture. Sometimes. We know theology and we know concepts. That's not the...
Right.
Lutherans struggle with just getting into the Bible. And I thought that's what you wanted.
Well, it is. I guess.
Yeah.
I guess this is kind of how I like to get into it.
Okay.
I don't know.
I was just thinking next time we could come at it with 4, 5, 6, and 7, each having what something that jumped out to us in terms of either a long view biblical idea or it would
sure.
involve us having to read the whole thing to find those points of emphasis. But
yeah.
then something that could summarize the whole chapter or help us to further understand, see the cross in the beginning, middle, and end.
Okay.
A little better, and it would just help us get through it a little faster. But it depends on your goal.
Well, let's try that then. I
okay.
mean, yeah, we'll see how it goes. See if our conversation is as, you know, whatever.
Heck, it might even
yeah.
go faster. We might get through Hosea the next take. If you're doing it from a helicopter view down, it shouldn't take more than 45 minutes to just like, dude, this verse was awesome. It definitely sums up chapter 4. In this way, what did you guys get? And
yeah.
each of us spits back an idea, and then chapter 5. And then sometimes chapter 5 needs to be read in context of chapter 4, so then
sure.
one of us spots that, and the other one. It would be more interesting to at least see where all our minds wander. There's also a sense where that could be really fun also.
Yeah. Yeah, so we'll do that. We'll try. You want to actually try to blast through the whole book and the next time, see what
Yeah,
happens?
let's try to do that.
Okay.
I should have more time coming this week, so.
All right. So chapters 4 through 14, next
Yep.
Sunday.
Let's kill it.
Looking forward to
And
that.
see if we learn absolutely nothing, then we'll go back to the way we were doing it.
Reevaluate.
But
Sure.
there's not there from what I know in Hosea, there isn't a ton left that isn't covered 1,000 times by the other prophets.
Sure.
There's some, and there's always new stuff, and that can be some of the stuff that we root through and try to find. But there's a lot of curses and blessings talk,
Yeah.
and
Yeah.
Israel going down, and the
Yeah.
coming exile, and it's very similar to other books of the Bible. And if you end up just talking about the things that we talk about, we're not scholastically inclined enough. We can't go through the Greek and Hebrew enough to make too many different points than the points we made tonight.
Right.
At least I would
It's
argue that.
a good thought. We'll give it a try. We'll give it a
Okay,
try.
cool.
Yeah.
Next week, 4 through 12,
4 through
each pick
14
a
through
4 through
14.
14. Pick your favorite, like, little passage. Try to do it within context, or at least know the context of what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And
Okay.
then we'll just see what each of us pulls out of every chapter. That'd be kind of cool.
All right, so that's going to be the end of that for tonight.
Cool.
Theology talk over.
Yeah,
Haven't figured out an outro yet. We'll get there. Thanks for watching, anybody who watched, and I'll put it up on YouTube tomorrow.
I will. Hi,
Yeah.
Mom.
Hi, Mom. Hi, YouTube. So it'll be on my YouTube channel on Monday. Anyway, thanks again.